Okay, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. The people that are standing, they are, can find some open seats here. So you can move and sit and relax. Okay, good morning, everyone. Again, my name is Yoshifumi Kitamura, the keynote speaker. So let me introduce the opening keynote speaker. It's my great honor for me to introduce the opening keynote speaker, Professor Takeo Kanade. Professor Kanade is a UA and Helen Whitaker University Professor of Computer Science and Robotics at Carnegie Mellon University. As everyone knows, he's one of the most famous professors who is active in the world. And therefore, I think I don't have to explain details here now, but just a little bit. He already received many prestigious awards for the tremendous achievements. As you know, in addition, I heard he will receive the Kyoto Prize next month. Congratulations. And I think it's a good idea to switch the PC. Professor Kanade.
Thank you for a kind introduction, Professor Kitamura-san. So I'm pleased to I'm honored, actually, to be invited to this great conference and give my talk. And I'd like to talk.
Okay. All right. So, you didn't hear my thank you note to the to the person who introduced me. I won't repeat. So, I'd like to talk about our project, which is Smart Headlight. Now, headlight is a great device when you drive, but for the last 120 years. The basic idea of the of headlight is the same, except the source of light has been changing or improved from acetylene to electric to halogen to xenon and LED. But the basic idea is that all our floodlight illuminators. In other words, a bunch of light goes out of your headlight to the scene and shine the world as bright as possible. So, however, what we like to discuss is what happens if we change the headlight to a spatially programmable light source. In other words, projector, basically the projector that we see over there, which project my screen. Now, this program has some history. Initially, back in 2010, around then, we developed what we named Aqualux 3D. It's a 3D display in the air with multiple water drops. It looks like this. This is 3D, by the way. The idea is that we have a set of, where's the green? All right, anyway, that's fine. So we have a set of water drops generator that each of which generate arose of, how to go back, okay. Yeah, drops. And we have a projector, and that projector sent a light, different light, to individual drops. Well, this appears as if, you know, the rows of raindrops, the drops, receive the same color. But since this is a projector, of course, you can control individual, the lighting of individual water. Now, water is very shiny object, as a matter of fact, even though it's made of water. Water drops is very shiny, even though it's made of water, which is transparent, because the round shape, circular shape, act as a lens and then reflect the light back to you. Now, so the device what we developed is made of water tank that provides a water to a rows of drop emitters. And then we have a camera which detects the locations of water drops, and then a projector which shines the light, the color of light that you want to individual drops. And indeed, we have worked a little bit, quite a bit about, students actually developed water drop emitter. It's a very interesting device. It's made of a pipe, and then needles are, arranged in with the fairly tight spacing, and then there's a solenoid switch, that valve that on and off the water to this feed. And it's interesting that the size of the diameter of the emitter, you have to have the right size, because if it's too big, water drops become, individual water drop becomes too big, and then it will break as it falls down. If it's too small, then you don't have the right amount of right size of the water drop. And then, as I said, as the water drops fall, this camera detects their locations, and then the projector sends the light accordingly. The result is like this. So it is actually a 3D display floating in the space. And so it was actually fun. I used to say that, what application, people ask. And the story I probably created is that when you have a baseball game and when it rains, the game is called off. But we say, no, don't let them go. Stay in these baseball stadium, and they say, we'll have a gigantic 3D display show. And the idea is we have multiple projectors surround the stadium, and then, the rain drops, and then we detect all of them and then send the light and create gigantic 3D display show. And probably you can get more, collect more money from the audience. Indeed, that was an idea, and that was not outrageous. And some people indeed showed some interest, even though that didn't happen. However, the original idea that we thought in this area is actually opposite. You see, this water drop display, the function of that is to send light to illuminate individual water drops. But the original idea is the opposite, to send the light so that the light selectively, so that the light will not hit the water drops, but go between them. That was our original idea. And why is it? What's for? Now, when you drive at night, you see to your view, the scene looks like this. Your headlight actually sent, as I said, flood of light, which will hit the raindrops. And then, as I said, the raindrops is very shiny. Therefore, they reflect back light to you, to the driver. And that's why the raindrops, as I said, keep saying, appear to be white, and they, make you a little more difficult to drive because you don't see the scene, okay? The idea is the following. Now, we replace the headlight with a projector, and as the raindrops fall down, we selectively turn on and off the rays of light of headlight so that, as you see, they don't hit the raindrops. Now, if you can do that, then naturally you would not see the raindrops. But all the lights go between the raindrops, hit the background, and then they come back to your eye. Therefore, it should be as if you're driving not a rainy day, but on a fine day, night. That was the goal and idea of this project. Now, you may think that, well, is that really possible? Actually, it is. It's relatively easy. The size of raindrops is about 0.1 to 4 millimeter, up to 10 millimeters. And snow is, snowflakes are a little bigger. The speed, terminal speed, as you know, the raindrop speed will not increase as they fall down from the sky because of the viscosity of the air. Indeed, if the air is not here with us, then the raindrop speed gets so high that they are very dangerous. But luckily, we have air, so the speed of the raindrops does not increase more than a certain speed, which is dependent on the size, meaning dependent on the weight of the raindrops. And the typical speed of the raindrops are, speeds of the raindrops are like 4 meters per second or up to 10 meters per second. So the speed is not that fast. Indeed, even though rain appears to us, to our eyes, as if they are a streak, because our eyes are slow. But if you use a camera whose exposure time is, say, 1 millisecond, then the raindrops look like dots, indeed, raindrops. Okay? And we're talking at night, and background is dark. Detecting raindrops in this field of view is not that difficult. Just thresholding would do. Okay? So once we understand that, what we should do is put the projector and camera at the same position, co-focal point arrangement. Therefore, the way you think you should think is, you should think a camera, basically, which is made of, say, CCD or CMOS pixels, and imagine that they not only can receive the light, but also individual pixel, imagine, can send the light, act as an illuminator or act as a headlight. Okay? Now, since they are in the same position, the incoming ray from a raindrop is the same as the outgoing ray of the projector. In other words, there's no disparity between the camera view and projector view. Therefore, what we should do is turn on the headlight very briefly, just very briefly. As soon as you turn on, take a picture, and then the picture would look like the one that I showed previously. Threshold it, detect where the raindrops are, in the pixel of the image, that's easy. And as soon as you do that, then turn off the ray, which corresponds ray of the pixel, which you see white dots. Okay? Then that raindrops will not receive the light any longer. And then you keep doing that very fast. Then it should be the case that no raindrops will receive light. Okay? So that's the basic idea. And in reality, we don't have, for the time being, have a device which can receive and light at the same time. Therefore, we put the projector and camera in the same position, which is also not possible. Therefore, put the beam splitter at 45 angle, and then this arrangement will make optically as if they are in the same position. Okay? So that's what we should do. Now, and then, oh, by the way, however, even though I said do this processing as fast as possible, but in reality, it takes a little time. Okay? So by the time that we know this pixel has received and noticed the, you know, this pixel, this particular pixel, you see the raindrop. But by the time that you know it, the raindrops will be a little lower. Okay? So what we should do is, when we see the raindrops at certain position, then, since it takes a little time, what you should do is probably you turn off definitely the pixel below it. Because by the time you control, the raindrops are a little lower. Okay? Now, the pixel which is above what you saw, where you saw the raindrops, is probably safer. Because by the time that you control, the raindrops has moved out of it. Okay? So by the same reason, the pixel a little bit above, left above right, they are safe. Left and right, they are also fairly safe. Lower left, lower right, well, who knows? The wind may bring these raindrops here. Okay? So it's a little dangerous. So you have a kind of a distribution of probability. Safe, fairly safe, okay safe, a little dangerous, very dangerous. So what you should do is inverse proportionally to that probability, you turn on and off the ray of light. Okay? Now, you may also wonder, now, isn't it impossible to detect the raindrops very far? But in reality, you don't need to worry about it, because to our view, to our eye, the raindrops very far is too small anyway. We don't see them. No way. No way to see them. Okay? Therefore, we should have a certain, we need to worry about certain range of operating range, which will be determined by the size of the picture of the raindrops. Because we human, driver, is of course basically a camera, is detecting the view, appearance of the raindrops. Therefore, the farther raindrops appear to smaller, therefore they're not as important to us. And that size will decrease, inverse distance z. Therefore, you need to worry about maybe somewhere far up to 5 or 6 meters. That's all we have to deal with. And the camera that sees that far at night is not that difficult. Moreover, don't forget the fact that we are talking night. And we have our own light source, so we can shine them as we want. All right. So, but don't forget the fact that the goal is not necessarily Even though what I said may sound as if we should definitely 100% avoid hitting the raindrops, but the goal is throughput. Indeed, if our goal is not to hit the raindrops at all, the best solution is, turn off the headlight. Then the light will never hit the raindrops. That's not good. Okay? So you have to turn on headlight. A goal is if you send amount of 100 lights, what percentage of that light will go between the raindrops? That percentage, throughput, is important. All right. And obviously, the throughput is dependent on the fall rate of the rain, because imagine the fall rate is so high and the raindrops cover the whole field of view, there's no way to avoid them. Huh? So that will decrease. Okay? And if we have... if we miss the location of raindrops, that will, of course, make the throughput lower. Okay? So it should be higher. Okay? So these are the simulation, what level of throughput we should have. And as an implementation, what we need to do is we have a spatial modulator, let's say a modulator, which is based, as I said, nothing but projector, camera, and they are connected by a single, very fast, real-time processor. That's all we have to have. And this is do-it-yourself smart headlight. Go and buy a projector, modify it. The reason that we have to modify is the following. As you know, today's the projector over there is made of a very bright light source with the DLP chip, DMD chip, array of small mirrors, okay? Which actually can work as fast as 2,000 frames, 2,000 hertz. But most projectors need only 60 frames frames per second speed, because the use is for us. But we want to make it faster. So we replace the interface so that we can actually have use the real capability of the chip, DMD chip. Yeah? And you may wonder what the brightness of the projector. Actually, they are very bright. They can go, the good one, as high as 4,000 lumens, which is about the same as our ordinary automobile headlight. Indeed, there are lots of, probably you know better than me, many attractions use a very bright projector to illuminate various patterns natural scenery or historical site at night, very far, very huge, like castle. Whole castle is projected, nice pictures, and then there's some entertainment in. So as that shows, the projector is very powerful, a light source. Okay? Once you modify it, you put camera in front of it with a mirror camera. And put the cover. Put it on the car. And we have a new car with a new headlight. And when you look at rain, you see less. Of course, that's how we designed it. No secret. And if you see snow, these are not the real snow, but I think artificially created snow. You see far less. Okay? And visibility has increased. Now, if you look at this device, it's very interesting technologically. As I said, what we did is almost trivial thing. See, as we take picture, transmit that image to the computer, process, and processing is almost nothing but thresholding. And then once we know where to turn on, where to turn off, send that signal to projector, and the projector turn on and off illumination. And the cycle time is 1.5 millisecond. Okay? Very fast. Yet, if you look at this chart, you see kind of stupidness of the whole idea here. Because you see, out of 1.5 millisecond, which should be as small as possible, processing real thing that you cannot avoid is the time to capture image. Of course, you have to collect some amount of data to know where the red raindrops are, so you cannot avoid this. And also, you cannot avoid processing. Okay? But the time that, the total time that was used for those two essential steps are only 0.4 millisecond. The rest is for transmitting between camera to processor, processor to illuminator. So this suggests that we should have a little better device which eliminate or minimize this transmission time, then the whole thing will become much easier, much better. Because as I said, faster you process, then this funny idea of expecting where raindrops will be removed. More than that, even though I sort of made it little fuzzy. In reality, as soon as if it takes time, then obviously the amount, the distance that raindrops move in the picture will be dependent on the distance where the z distance is of the raindrops. In other words, the disparity issue comes into play. And as a vision person, I know disparity is the worst thing to deal with, yeah? Because it's very difficult to measure the distance. Yeah? So the good thing is, if we can make time, if you can make time, this one, basically zero, then this part will go away. And the 100% the efficiency will be achieved. Except, of course, a mistake of recognizing raindrops. Okay? Other than that. Okay, and this is some old data, I think. It's not still good, you know. The accuracy is about 70% at the best. So it goes down much faster than the better the case of with better recognition rate. Now, will this device be real use? I hope it will be. Yet, I guess it'll take some time until somebody think it's a good idea and valuable device. And also, we have to solve a very now interesting problem and very difficult problem, which is windshield. Yeah, even though we may eliminate raindrops from your field of view, windshield will still receive raindrops. So to make it perfect story, we have to have we have to develop the raindrops, which will not create the, you know, make this disturbance, and Viper does this, which is not good. Okay? So if anybody has a good idea to eliminate windshield, then the whole story will be completed. Now, yet there are quite a few more, a little more realistic applications. One of them is headlight high beam, low beam, or up beam, low beam an issue. When you drive at night, naturally you'd like to drive with high beam, up beam, okay? Because it's easier to see far, especially when you're driving countryside. That's right? Yeah, you want to do that. However, when you use a high beam or up beam, then the oncoming car driver will receive a flood of light like this. And for that period of time, it will glare, will make the driver, oncoming car's driver, basically blind for a short period of time. And I was told a scary story. People like me, 70 years old, and many of you possibly older than 55 years old, you have to be careful. The duration of that period during which you're basically driving with your eye closed is almost six times longer than 15 or 16 years old young guy. It's very dangerous. That's why, actually, the glare causes accident at night. Therefore, that's why you're required to change it lower as soon as you see the oncoming car. However, once we realize that we have this projector which can control spatially on and off, we don't need to do that. All we have to do is to turn off the beam rays of light, which will hit the eye of the oncoming driver. If you do that, then the oncoming driver won't see your headlight as a high beam at all. Indeed, if it's perfect, in other words, if there's no diffusion of light, he won't even see your headlight, completely dark, which is, of course, dangerous. We're lucky. The world is not like that. Diffuse light, therefore you see it. But no direct light. That's why, therefore, you won't see your high beam, up beam headlight as a glare, but just bright car. Okay? So like this. And then also, we have a very nice situation. We are talking at night. So as soon as you see a big, round, white thing, pair of it, coming at you, which means in the picture, the distance, the size is becoming a little larger and larger, and the distance, this is becoming wider and wider, that's a headlight. As soon as you see that, then in the United States, from your side, this is where the driver is. In Japan, this is where the driver is. Therefore, that portion of the light should be lowered or turned off, and then it will work. And the same is true with the rear mirror. Isn't it annoying when you're driving at night, the guy from behind you shine a light, and then this rear mirror will be very bright, and you don't see what's behind you because it's so bright. Therefore, what you should do is turn off the headlight, which will hit this portion of your car in front of you, the car in front of you, okay? All right, now when you do that, then you are using high beam, so you are shining the world as bright as possible. Yet, for the driver of the oncoming car, you see, our car is not bright at all. See? So this means that you are driving always high beam or up beam. The oncoming car sees you always low beam. And that's what we want. And this is the rear mirror. So we are shining the car in front of you 100%. If we don't use our capability, it's like that. But if we use it, you see, the guy of the car in front of you can see you. Without that, it's bright, too bright. But if we use our capability, then the car will see you. Not right now. See you, who you are, and what your car is like. Yeah? So it's good too. And also, today, many cars are now capable to drive by itself, which means they know where the lanes, where the driving lanes are. Therefore, this headlight can send more lights to your driving lane to tell you where you should drive. Okay? And this is especially important in unmarked road in the countryside, because don't you have that experience when you drive countryside, which is not as familiar, then the road edge is not as visible. Then you can see, you can send more light of the driving lane. Of course, we are sending more lights here too. Just sending here 100% is dangerous, because who knows, your program may be wrong, you know. So not 100%. Okay? And so the case is also true for bicyclist or pedestrian. The car has laser, car has infrared camera, which can detect these pedestrians, bicyclists, probably faster and more reliably than your human eyes. And therefore, once they are detected, then the smart headlight can send more lights to pedestrian, bicyclist, so that the drivers can see them better. Okay? And then that will be probably very important capability. And the device can be miniaturized and to the size that can be put in the actual car's headlight, like this. You see a mirror here. This one's actually does not use, exactly separate, because the distance is small enough, so the disparity doesn't matter. So that's a smart headlight. And one of the things that I always sort of tease people, maybe like you, who are doing augmented reality. Do you do augmented reality? Nobody? Okay, good. so this, don't take it personal. This is just teasing you. Many people say, okay, we have an augmented reality, you know? And then, like a Pokemon Go, is that, yeah? That's augmented reality, right? Say, okay, we see it. Or when we see a building and do this, and then the building name appears. Or like this, and then you see an object appears. Or when you see, point to the person, then his name or her name will appear here. Augmented reality, it's called. And I said, isn't that really augmented reality? I say, I don't think so. It should be called augmented display of reality. Because if I remove it, I don't see them anymore. Reality is not augmented at all. See, display is augmented. So they should have named it augmented display of reality. And augmented reality, I think, is overstatement. So that's my tease to those people who do the augmented reality. And I say, well, and then I claim, isn't what we're doing the real augmented reality? Because the reality is indeed augmented. Indeed. Like projecting more lights to bicycle, pedestrian. In the case of rain, it's probably decreased reality because the rain appears to be gone. Yeah? So it's a decreased reality, real. Yeah? That's my the tease of to those people who do the augmented reality. I'm glad that not many of you do that. Because once I gave this talk to a conference of augmented reality, and I said the same thing, and then I was very unpopular afterward. All right. Now, one thing that we should realize is camera and projection, they're the same thing. Only difference, they are optical dual. In the case of camera, from scene, light starts, goes through lens, and converge to image plane. Projector is opposite. From projector, projector plane, go through, light is emitted, and then go through lens, and converge to the scene. No difference between the two, optically. That's indeed the property that we use in creating smart headlight. Therefore, once we realize that, the projector that we see over there is this device which has a light source, and this DMD chips modulate, basically, control the direction and brightness and so forth. Brightness in terms of time coding modulate. And therefore, if you see the inverse of this optical process, is the light comes, hit this chip, and then reflected onto imager. And then this device can actually modulate this light. If you do this, then a lot of new things will appear. Simplest thing is the exposure time. Exposure time of today's camera, the concept of exposure time is for each frame. With this, we can define exposure time for each pixel because we can control the duration of the time that will go during which the light actually go to individual pixel. So my colleague, Professor Narasimhan, has developed a very interesting device which can actually eliminate only parts that are moving and then create much very fast imager. Because the CMOS chips can actually access light pixel much, much faster as long as we don't access all of them. Yes. We can actually control these things at the same time. And also, by using this basic same idea, Professor Narasimhan Srinivas has been very successful in developing a new shape sensor which can actually sense the shape of transparent, half-transparent device, material like a shower curtain, which is very difficult to measure the shape because of the optical property. But his device can do that. He can also do things like measuring the shape of a water bottle, a PET bottle, which is half shiny, and also can detect the how much water is there and the like. Okay. A very interesting device. He can also do shape measurement of very shiny device, object like a metal lamp, and probably very important, practical importance is for industrial part, which is shiny. Many industrial parts are shiny because they are made of metal or shiny plastic. And industrial automation application has to deal with them, but most existing shape measurement devices don't work very well with those very shiny plastic or metal, but his device can do. Also, he can do shape measurement with a very bright, under very bright sun. Okay? Kinect is an excellent device, yet if you use a Kinect outside, they tend not to work very well. The reason is the energy that Kinect sends, a traditional shape measurement device send, is so low compared to the bright sun, probably factor of 1,000 or even 10,000 lower. Therefore, there's no match. And the light energy that you send out, the sensor sends out, is completely washed out by the sunlight. But he has a device which can actually take care of that. And this is even impressive. He has a bright 7,000 lumens ambient light, and the scanner has only 20 lumens, and still it works. This is more impressive. His device can actually measure turned on shape of a turned on lamp. The lamp is actually emitting light for itself, and he sends light to it. And then the amount of light that is reflected, which correspond to the light that he sent, can be detected. I like this one most interesting because I'm a traditional roboticist, and I thought this is never possible. Therefore, in summary, I think I did extraordinarily well on time. Usually I speak about 20 minutes longer than the time that I allocated. I'm a little afraid that I left too much time for questions which I hate to answer. So maybe I should spend a little longer time here. In summary, more generally speaking, the projector camera system is the system that use a projector as spatially, temporarily programmable light modulator, and a camera as spatially or cameras. There's no limit that you have to use only one. You can use multiple combinations. Spatially, temporally programmable light detectors. So in total, we have at least 6 DOF, degrees of freedom, control to the device that both receive and send out light. And if you combine with low latency, high bandwidth, vision processor, which is coming along, as you know. Many low power processors is coming along. Many companies are making them. I was involved in a company called Movidius, which appears to be bought by Intel. They are low power processor. And then, of course, things like a neurochip, chips which are coming as the device processor, which takes much, much less power than a little more power-hanging, hungry device like NVIDIA's device. Of course, they are also looking at low-power device too. But if they become low power, then all of these three things can be packed into one device and then might be able to produce interesting, a new class of vision and system, vision systems. So that's what I wanted to say, and indeed, many good work come from this group, and I'm pretty sure there are more newer people here, but this is a little older information. Okay, so that's my story today. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the inspiring, very inspiring talk. Probably have questions to ask Professor Kanade at this moment. Raise your hand. The student volunteer will run to you. And raise your hand.
Hi. I was wondering if the latency problem could be solved by, say, having an array of cameras that each sort of take pictures, but they're sort of very slightly apart. Would that help or not really?
It should. Indeed, the best. I think at some point people are talking about this, but I don't think even I was thinking about it. As you know, CMOS, the chip device, memory, for example, is also. Light detector. So the simplest do-it-yourself device that you can do is open your memory, you know, DRAM or SRAM, open it, and then put the lens in front of it, and then actually that becomes camera. And this one is good because you don't, then the memory is the camera, therefore there's no way, no need to read them out. It's there already. So because of that property, it's very thinkable, and I'm pretty sure at some point there might be a device which does that. Then you have a 2D array of chip, camera, which does not need to read out like today under a certain protocol. Then some of the transmission time will be eliminated. And of course, conceptually, you can also think to combine emitter with a sensor, the device that I used to, as an explanation of the idea. And I think people may have done it. I don't know. Now, that has, of course, fundamental challenge. That is, the emitting light requires some energy, and can you actually pack it in a small device, so which probably you have to deal with the power, meaning the heat of the device. And I'm pretty sure there's, device people need to work if that kind of arrangement becomes practically useful. And this type of device or this kind of a camera, projector camera system idea, if they become real and they should be packed in a very small one and then sell it as a single device. Say, here's a device which does everything in one stroke, projector, camera, and computer, then that type of device will be, I think, thinkable and, well, thinkable, it's been thinkable for many years, and possibly meaningful device.
Okay. Excuse me, can you turn the stage Yes. So, you?
Since you're doing real augmented reality, I was wondering if you have thought about combining your original idea with this idea and projecting, for example, turn-by-turn driving directions onto the rain or onto the snow out in front of me.
Yes.
So use it as a display, actually.
Yeah. Now, very good question. We, indeed, one of the joke that I used to use, you see, I like to create the joke, is the following. I didn't talk. Very interesting thing is the following. When you drive rainy days, a snowy day, I think the value is probably less than the device that will help you driving in a fog. Okay? Now, in the fog, you don't see in front. But laser, another device, can see front. And, of course, as you know, most likely, especially in freeway, car knows where to drive. Okay? Therefore, if you can project the knowing pedestrian or bicycle or the freeway, no pedestrian, but the car in front of you or other object or lane, if you project that image to the fog, then you can drive. Okay? Now, the problem is disparity. You cannot project the picture of a guy in front to in the fog by using the fog as a screen, which doable, definitely. Okay? But you have to give the impression of the correct impression of the distance to the car in front of you, in front of a driver, or and so forth. Therefore, you have to have a real image at the correct distance, okay? Which is not easy. Okay? Now, how can you do? Well, I often think that the best solution is put the electrode to your brain so that rather than using image projection, send the image to your brain and so that you actually feel that image. Yet most likely you don't want this, I guess. Therefore, the next solution is to use multiple light source and project converge image to at the right distance, like many, you know, ultrasound device to deal with tumor and so forth. They have a disparity and then converge to a particular point and then energy get there. So you can think of the same thing, okay? And somebody computed for me and told me, I didn't do that myself, told me that the width of the car is not good enough. We need a little bigger baseline to have a practical convergence, okay? So I said, why not we have a pole car. So car has high pole and get the disparity vertically this way. Yeah? I thought a good idea and then some people didn't like it. To kill then we can pass the overhang passage. So we're not pursuing that idea yet. Okay. Therefore, if anybody can come up with a good idea, I think it's probably your field, user interface. I like to use it.
'Yes. Hi. I had a more of a philosophical question, and I was wondering what motivated you to come up with the headlight idea, because I think normally as humans we tend to, I think, accept things the way they are, like this is how a car works, this is how a headlight works, and how did you sort of flip that idea upside down?
The idea itself, as I said, I had this idea for a long time. I think I got the original idea back probably 90s when we were doing some autonomous driving with some company. And I said this idea to them and they said, no way I can do it, number one. No way people will buy it, so we didn't do it. And then Narasimhan Professor Narasimhan said, okay, let's do it by changing the order, display first, and then that's how we progressed. So answering your question, how did I get this type of idea? Is that your question? I don't know. I'm a fairly free thinker, and as long as it's fun, I would do. Though I claim good research always come from the thinking of idea, thinking that takes has to think hard about actual usefulness of your idea. So that's my philosophy. So maybe somehow I felt this is useful. Sorry, I don't have a good answer to your question.
So there's just a many.
But probably I should say this. If you're a student, I think the good idea will often come out from interesting. See, interesting, the word interesting is interesting. Indeed. What does that really mean, interesting? Okay, we often say that, that's an interesting idea. What does that mean? I think that the idea that will make people think, sort of make them feel fun to do it, believing what you're doing is useful. And so I think that's the most basic feeling that you should have in order to do a good research. And sometime I'm asked to give a talk, what makes you a better researcher? And that's my statement. Okay. You have to enjoy your research. And this is not that kind of a talk today, but I'd like to actually tell I'd like to brag one point. That is, once I gave a talk of research to a bunch of people outside of the engineering community, one of the audience raised hand, and he asked me, Professor, how much are you paying to Carnegie Mellon in order to do what you're doing? So apparently, I gave him an impression, I'm enjoying it. Yeah. So I hope, and then I feel that was the best compliment I've ever had. That question. Okay.
Because I'm not going to have two ones. One, please.
My question is, so like I'm a new driver, and the first few times I drove on the road, I received some like angry flashing, from the car behind me. And that is, quite useful to me because that reminds me that maybe I'm not, obeying the rules or sort of like maybe not.
I see.
Yeah, and I'm wondering, what, like, your system sort of like kind of act as a filter, which probably like sometimes will filter out some useful information of the environment. And maybe another example is like when you filter out the reflection of the rain, will it inevitably change my perception of the road condition so that, maybe the rain's very big and then I didn't even notice it, and then which may cause some other dangers?
Yeah, I don't have an answer to that, actually. So as you speak of that, I thought maybe this is your field, user interface field, right? Indeed, the best interface is user don't feel that they have an interface at all. It's a natural. If you think naturally what the interface want you to think, isn't that the best user interface? Maybe that's what I think the field should work on. Okay. Rather than here's an interface, okay. Rather than that, somehow the user gets the idea what the system is doing, and the system gets the idea what you want without interface, without thinking as if they are, without thinking that they're using, quote, interface. Maybe that's the best interface. There might be something of that nature already. So if you collect some of those examples, which might be primitive at this point, but think collect them and then really work, think hard. What properties do they have? Yeah, even when they are primitive at this stage, and then ask question: can you do it more real? And then there might be an interesting area. Make sure you credit Takeo Kanade to that idea if you do that. Thank you.
Okay, one more last question. Probably goodbye. Yes, please.
Yes, thank you. During your talk, you mentioned, or you briefly showed a frame where a bicyclist was riding in front of the vehicle and they were filtered out. I thought that was great. And what I'm wondering is, what challenges remain in applying that sort of filtering technology to other domains, such as if you're a presenter and you walk in front of the projector, in front of the screen, you'll be blinded by the projector light. Is that problem solved already?
Yes. People have done that. As you said, this is sometimes annoying, and that's okay because it's afar. At the conference where a projector is close, you have that problem, right? So I think at least I have seen more than one paper, but the one particular one that I know is the guy at Intel Pittsburgh did that. I don't think that become a real, capabilities. I think my guess is that part of increase of the cost to add that property may not justify the value that they perceive. But if you think, if the cost, as you said, because the cost of computing is getting lower and lower, and you know that projector now has a camera, and many of them do have camera, and a small computer, because as you can actually adjust various things like a pink cushion or pedestrian shape so that it appears to straight. Okay? So they actually have a camera in order to do that automatically. Therefore, if the additional cost to program what you just said, which has been at least tried, can be done without really adding any cost, then I'm pretty sure that will be used.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I think you have more questions or objections about his statement about augmented reality, for example, but I'm sorry, my role is to keep the time. So I have to conclude this session. And Dr. Kanade will be with us until afternoon, probably. Yes. So you can have a chance to chat with him. Okay, thank you very much again, Professor Kanade.
Thank you.
Do you have an announcement from locals?